Welcome, my brothers and sisters. I'm Fred Stankus from the Avatar MeherBaba Center of Southern California. And with me today on this program are Marguerite Poley, artist, and Jurgis, Sapkus, artist and sculptor. This program is similar to a MeherBaba meeting that is conducted every Saturday night at our center here in West Los Angeles. What we'd like to convey with you is some of our experiences of knowing of MeherBaba and who Baba is. is and how he basically is integrated into our daily lives. Marguerite was born in Switzerland, and she came to this country in the 20s. And Jurgis was born in Lithuania, and he has quite an interesting story to tell, too. Marguerite resides in Canoga Park, Jurgis in Manhattan Beach. Welcome.
Thank you.
Marguerite. You were born in Switzerland.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about your background that basically brought you to MeherBaba and also into your work as an artist?
All right, I'll certainly try. I was born at Zurich, Switzerland in 1909. And since when I was a child, I was very interested in God. I was interested in Francis of Assisi. And I was always considering God as the enigma that one had to try to solve. So it took a little ways for me to get to eventually knowing MeherBaba. What happened was my father was very fond of horses. He used to carry me around, and if the horse was parked in the street, he'd always fish in his pockets and get a lump of sugar, and he told me how to hold my hand real flat so that the horse would nibble my hand instead of the sugar. Anyway, one thing led to another. In 1925, I became a horse lover, and I still am. The horse is still my favorite animal. In 1925, I came to America. My father had passed away in 1918 during the Spanish influenza, the Spanish grip, which took so many in Europe at that time. And when I arrived here, I taught French at NYWCA in Cleveland, Ohio, which is not exactly where I landed at first, which was at a very small town near Painesville called Thompson, Ohio. Only a store and a sort of an office in a general store, and that was it. Then I taught French for a while, a conversational French for advanced students. And then at a horse show, I met a lady who was a horsewoman, and she took me in as a protege, and eventually I played fairs with a Wild West show, all over the South mainly, and Gus Hornbrook's Cheyenne Days, it was called. And then in 35, oh yes, and we played different spots around the area, the Cleveland Stadium during the air races.
And let me ask you, you played the horse show, you were a rider?
Oh yes, I became a professional rider.
In other words, a bareback rider or stand-up rider?
I became an all-round equestrian, oh yes, and I did stunts.
Trick ride.
Everything. You name it. I mean, I used to be able to stand on a horse and jump, and it's not very difficult to learn to stand on a horse. Your feet don't mean so much as it's in your head, you know, and you get used to it. You have a few falls, but you get used to it. But anyway, in 35, we had to come to California, and this is where I joined the L.G. Bonds Circus.
What was the name?
L.G. Bonds Circus, a subsidiary of Ringland, well, the Ringland Show, and their headquarters were at Baldwin Park. And so I went on tour with them for a couple of years. We toured Canada from Vancouver to Halifax and many other states. And that's where a horse in Canada fell on me at Shawinigan Falls in province of Quebec and injured my back. I had a broken sacral iliac and some of the things on the side of your spine, and that set me down for the first time. I was very upset because I feared I could no longer follow my vocation. And however, I had to resort to God, but it was not enough to bring me further into God. So then, like everybody else, I did. I worked in a wall plant in 8,000 Wood Lane, Van Nuys, and that's where I had another very serious injury. I'm telling you, because they will eventually lead to MeherBaba. And I was completely scalped in a power shear, and that really did it. I didn't want to live. I didn't want to put up with this. And I was in and out of hospitals, and a friend of mine was there, and she was a seeker, so like I was, and very quickly I went through all these different things, theosophy, Rosencrucians, and nanoscience, and all this thing, and nothing satisfied me until I read a book by L. Adam Speck, which was the story of Oriental philosophy, and I read this book, and I was fascinated. This is for me. I thought, this is for me. One thing led to another. Drawing Eugene Adriel, a disciple of MeherBaba's. And I met Jean Adriel, and I was very taken in. And eventually, when Jean went to India in 1948, she took a painting I had done of a Pegasus to give to MeherBaba. And then when she came back the following December, she said, Baba, I really like that painting, which I'm very fond of Pegasus, by the way. He's an inspiration. Anyway, it all led up to my meeting MeherBaba when he came to visit the United States in 1956. And there were four of us who were a welcoming committee. One of them had gone to New York to meet MeherBaba there. And I remember going down Sepulveda Boulevard. It was pitch dark. The train was to arrive at crack of dawn practically, so we got there and we met. We had never met before. We were the welcoming committee, but we only had met by telephone. There were very few of us knowing about Baba in this general area. So we went down there and we just gravitated toward one another. We knew who we were, and then we waited. Baba came toward us. He had quite an entourage with him, and he walked toward us. It was quite majestic. Everybody was sort of leading him and yet staying behind him. And he embraced us, and of course, that I'll never forget that embrace, because here were some arms around me, but I couldn't feel anything. I didn't feel anything. All I could feel was this absolute incredible bliss. I felt like, oh, if only this could last forever. I should backtrack a little, because I met MeherBaba inwardly reading a book named Avatar in 47, and when I read that book at a certain passage, something said, oh my God, this is God. It was a thunderbolt, because I was in blissful for quite a while, and I just couldn't get over it. It was almost as if my body could not contain it. Fly asunder. So anyway, one thing led to another, and after meeting Baba, I had the wonderful opportunity to meet him again for a sahavas. A sahavas means meeting with the Baba and receiving his darshan love. And so I went to Myrtle Beach too, which was a horrendous trip to get there, but finally made it. And so MeherBaba is my whole life. The word avatar means, in Sanskrit, avatar, which means it's an incarnation, a descent. Or an epiphany, and if you look up that word, it means that it's the same thing. You can look it up in Webster's and you'll find it. So MeherBaba now is somebody I feel is everywhere present. And he is... I thank him for everything, and I find that it's such a wonderful gift that people should really be grateful for life. It is the one thing which will eventually lead us to God. And as far as I'm concerned, MeherBaba is. He was Zoroaster, he was Ram, Krishna, Buddha, Jesus, Allah, and finally MeherBaba. He's the one that came here to wake us up. He said he did not come to teach a new religion or some form of dogma. He just wanted to wake us up, and he's known as the Awakener.
Thank you, Marguerite. I think there are some kind of technical problems with the movement by your microphone, so I guess, you know.
Oh.
Anyway, about the... painting that we have here. This is a painting done by Marguerite, and it's called, what is that?
This is called Love's Descent, 20th Century. Baba is known mythologically as the White Horse Avatar. And because of my life with horses and so forth, I've always been very fond of having worked with them, of trying to sketch horses, which I had no opportunity to do until I had my head injury. I was always too busy. And finally, I decided to just paint him, preferably and mainly on a white horse, and this happens to be one of the paintings.
And that painting was produced when?
In 86.
1986.
And it is donated to our center, which has a lovely place every summer over the July period of silence over at Pilgrim Pines, where we have speakers from India, speakers from all kinds of walks of life, and we have wonderful people.
Is that a particular mountain range background,
no,
or is that just something in your imagination?
No, it's just something that occurred and also in the horse's mouth for fun, because no self-respecting horse will go down the mountainside without picking up a flower or two, you know. A little whimsy with it.
You started painting when? Right after the war, was it?
One of my surgeon's wife was at Otis. She was attending Otis Foundation on Wilshire Boulevard, and she got me in when nobody, it was impossible to get in. It was just, it happened. I took a few pieces of work to Schrader, the dean, and then they let me go in, and it was very crowded. We had a lot of GIs, we had a lot of people there. It was very crowded.
So in other words, this was during the war?
This was
Second World War.
I was in and out of hospitals for 2 years, and when FDR passed away and all that, I was in the hospital.
I can recall you mentioning that they're related to your scalp, injury. You had a series of dreams, and these dreams were extremely, in fact, nightmarish times.
Yes, I had.
But they were very poignant from the point of view of giving you somewhat of a guide or a message. Is that true?
Yeah. First of all, I had one morning I woke up, and that was before I met Baba even. And this voice, I wasn't quite awake. I said, "Marguerite, wake up." I think I'd recognize that voice if I heard it again today. I wake up from what? What is this? What's going on? You know, but eventually I had a feeling what it was. And then after I had my head injury, I had terrible nightmares. I had these devils come and take a hold of me, and I was absolutely powerless. You could not see them. They would have this raucous laughter, and they tried to strain my physical body through a wall. And I screamed, and I said, "Oh God, and Jesus, in the name of Jesus, deliver me from this." Nothing happened. I said it a second time, nothing happened. And a third time I said it, and I was released. Another time, I had a devil drag me into a great big hall in the wall after, you can't resist it. I mean, I don't know who these beings were, but they put me in a black hole in a, and I wake up, the bed would be covered with sweat. And another time, I was put in a Chinese torture chamber where you cannot stand or sit, and again I knew I was sweating, and it was agony. And finally I said, "Oh God, only if thou willest this will I put up with it for all eternity." And when I said this, I felt happy. I really truly felt that I would be able to do this. So this lovely being comes walking towards me, and she takes me by the wrist, and the bamboo bars, whatever, everything vanished. And when I met Jean Adriel, she was showing me some photographs of the women, this mother's women disciples. And I said, "You remember that dream I told you about? This is the lady who took me by the wrist. This is Mehera, Meher Baba's chief woman, women disciple. This is, this just did a head of Mehera."
Well, now you reside in Canoga Park, and
now I reside in Canoga Park, and I thank Baba every minute of every moment of my life. I'm a very happy person because I feel that whatever comes along, we each have our own path to follow, and for each one, that path is his own, her own path.
We're back again now with our second part of Meher Baba's Artists. And now, my second guest is Jurgis Sapkus. Cape Tao. We're both Lithuanian. Jurgis' background comes from his name Sapkus, my name Stankus, so we're both Lithuanian, and it's highly unusual to meet a Lithuanian here in Los Angeles. And it's good to have you on. And Jurgis, you were born in Lithuania, and then I understand during the Second World War you were a refugee Germany. You went to Austria and then came back to Germany?
Yes, yes.
And I understand that you were a dancer and an artist. Dancer. But the thing is, can you bring us at that point? Basically, you were kept out of a concentration camp?
No. To avoid any forced labor in Germany, I was in Austria, went in Vienna. I had to find some kind of work, which is suitable. And there was organized Lithuanian folk dancing and singing.
Folk dancing and singing?
Yeah, ensemble. See, and it was called Čiurlionis.
Čiurlionis, what does that mean?
Čiurlionis is the name of one of the famous Lithuanian painters who actually started paint abstract before any abstraction was even known in the world. But it was a little different. It was kind of more symbolic and type of thing. Yeah. Anyway, that was the name of the ensemble. And we performed in Vienna and we sang in different places in churches. And when the war moved closer, we had to move. I mean, there was kind of like, we had to move to Berlin.
So,
right in the time when Berlin was, surrounded and...
Oh my, so and the last bomb, days
bombed,
of Berlin.
Yes, bombed very badly. And in that time, we performed for German soldiers.
At their barracks?
Yes, in the barracks, from one place to another, just like entertaining group.
Uh-huh.
And sing and dance folk song. I mean folk dances, and that's the type we survived. And then later we all together escaped from Berlin because it was too dangerous. We escaped pretending that we are just passers-by from East. See, in that time in Berlin, everybody who was in that area supposed to stay there. And the people who came from East, a lot of refugees and all kinds of, and soldiers and refugees, they were moved through Berlin fast away. So what we did, we actually walked all together, and since we could speak foreign language, we just said that we're just coming right now.
I see,
and
so.
And I get passage to the...
So you fled,
west
sort of disguised as a refugee.
Yeah,
then
we went close
leaving.
To the Swiss border.
So you got to the Swiss border.
Yes.
And then
we awaited the end of the war in that time.
You stayed in Switzerland. And then
not in Switzerland, on the border.
The border. And then you arrived in the U.S. in what year?
In the U.S. I arrived in 1952.
Did you, were you married at this time?
Yes, I was married and I had a little baby with me, my son.
You said, so yeah. You met your wife Julia in Germany.
In art school in Freiburg. Freiburg Art School.
Oh, so your background in art school is Freiburg.
Yeah, I studied in Freiburg and Munich. At beginning in Freiburg, that was actually Lithuanian organized school and was supported by French government.
I see.
Because in Freiburg was French occupied area.
I see. And so then in 52 you went to Chicago, is that it?
To Chicago, that's right.
And you lived on what part of Chicago? What side?
I lived
in Cicero.
I didn't live in Cicero, I was there. But we started in South
Chicago.
Chicago and Lincoln Park. What was Park that? South Chicago. Highland Park.
Highland Park.
Highland Park. Highland that Park. Area. Then later I moved every 6 months in
right.
place.
And so then you were in Chicago for about how many years?
10 years.
10 years and then you came
I studied
to
there a little bit and I worked in Stengler's studio.
For Stengler's studio.
Uh-huh.
And then you came to Los Angeles
in 62. And this is where I find out about Baba. See?
How'd you find out about Baba?
I met Phyllis Frederick. She was working in Mattel, and I get a job in Mattel about the same time.
Mattel toys.
Yes.
What did you do at Mattel?
Designing. At the beginning, I get sculpture job, but then later I moved to designing mechanical
types of contraptions.
Yes,
and things
yes,
like that.
Yes. Mechanical walking dolls and things like that. I'm still doing this type of
some kind of consulting work.
For my survival, so to say. With art is not enough.
So basically you met Phyllis, I guess she was sort of like standing on the corner one morning.
Yeah, I will tell you.
Yeah.
See, Phyllis didn't have a car, okay? But I didn't know about her, nothing. But we lived just a few houses apart, see? And when I was driving around the corner of Highland and Rosecrans, in that time Rosecrans was still with the big eucalyptus trees, and I saw a lady standing with coffee cup and with gray hair, you know, hanging like this, and no makeup, nothing, and she looked so wonderful, and I always, each morning I would see her there. I thought, oh, that's a wonderful person, I would like to meet her, see? And once somebody came and says, you live close by Phyllis, why don't you give a ride to her? I don't know who Phyllis was, but that was the lady, see? And then she was talking about Baba, and for me it was so strange, and, you know, I just liked the lady, and I was interested in new things, was kind of, but in general, it didn't mean much to me, you know? Only when, you know, like Baba said himself, you have to step couple steps and he will come 10 steps towards you. And really that's what happened to me, really. I unconsciously kind of just read little bit there, and until once, that was in 68, there was a little group of Baba lovers around Phyllis in that time. And Phyllis says, well, there is a letter from India. And we all went to her house at lunchtime. And she took the letter and she read the letter, and it was from Mani. And there was a message that every Baba lover should read these prayers, master prayer and prayer of repentance, every day for a certain time, I don't know, 2 months or so, audible. And then we made Xerox copies, and I get one Xerox copy, you know, and I took to my office. And in that time, when I come into office, that there was some kind of trouble with telephone, and my office was open, you know, open the floor, and all telephone wires were unbelievable, all colors, all telephones, full office of telephone wires. So I get inside, and I didn't know what to do, so I took the, you know, the prayers, and I start reading. And when I start reading, O Parvardhikar, the preserver and protector of all, it everything what I read, it seemed to me so real, and so something what I knew that it is, something that I knew a long time ago, you know? And each time something get in my, and start rising here, you know? And I start crying. I could not control myself. I never cried, you know, for ages. And that was, you know, like it was not because I sad, not because I happy. Something touched my soul, you know, very, very deep.
That's the master's prayer.
Yeah, master's prayer, yeah. When I read master's prayer. And then I was kind of embarrassed because the doors were open, right. So I tried to close the door, you know.
Yeah.
And really, that's the thing, you know, that's why, you know, when you talk about Baba and everything, you know, it is, you have to be touched by in heart, you know. And I know everybody, like you, yeah, and Margaret, I'm sure they have some little story where they were touched right deep in the heart. And that's the thing, when you are not all the philosophizing, and
right. I'd like to ask you, we have only a couple minutes left, just about your beautiful work here. These are sculptures, and yeah, this is Mera, and this is MeherBaba.
Yes.
And
yes.
When did you produce these?
That was done in 67, and I brought them to India as present for Mehera. On Mera's birthday, which is right before Christmas.
And
this is Sapkus.
Done in 87, you mean?
It's 87, I'm 87, sorry.
87, or 1987,
yeah, 1987,
right. And you brought it to India for Mera's birthday, yeah, in December, yeah. Mm-hmm. 87.
That's right, yeah.
And, well, they're beautiful.
Yeah.
And if for information to your audience, is the Mera is recognized as Baba's most beloved disciple. And, of course, Baba. And I'm sure this is quite a beautiful, yeah, gift.
And those copies will go to Myrtle Beach.
In Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, there's a MeherBaba Spiritual Center, 500 acres right on the Grand Strand of Myrtle Beach. Well, it's about the time to wrap up the program, and I really appreciate you being here, Jurgis.
Thank you, Fred. Thank you.
And Marguerite, thank you so much for being here. It's been a wonderful sharing time, and we hope to see you again soon on the program.
I'm Alex.